Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. Good morning.
Thanks for coming out. I am Steve Wallace, your town planner. I've been a professional planner for 35 years now, 10 years in New Hampshire and 25 years here in Massachusetts. The bulk of my experience has been helping towns under 10,000 people work through their planning and zoning issues. So, enjoying living in this area, when I saw that Sterling was looking for a town planner, I thought this might be an ideal situation where I could render some assistance. So that's why I'm here. Just one rule for this morning. Let's keep it positive. Let's try to understand that we're all in this room this morning for the same reason. We love Sterling and we want to keep it nice, we want to make it better. We can disagree on how to do that, but my role as your planner is to make sure that you have all the facts at your disposal so that you can make an informed decision when the time comes. All right, so as I go through my presentation today, if I say something you don't understand or you have a question, please just raise your hand and we'll get it sorted out right then and there. I want us to proceed this morning all having the same information. All right, so with that said, here's what we're gonna cover today. The importance of economic development, its impact on community services, its impact on residential tax bills. And then we're going to do an exercise aimed at getting at your preferences for economic development. We do have an area in town that represents our most immediate opportunity for economic development. And we're going to talk about that today and try to get a handle on what you'd like to see there. So let's move forward here. Benefits of economic development. It creates good jobs in the region for the people in the region, promotes family and housing stability. If a person has a good job, they're likely to stay in their home for a good long while. If they stay in their home a good long while, well, that promotes family stability. You're not moving every few years. Also strengthens community fabric. If you've got people who live in town for a while, at some point they're likely to want to get involved in the town affairs, whether as a civic volunteer or a volunteer in one of your various municipal boards. So. And lastly, it stabilizes local tax rates, and we're going to get into that in detail. I understand that you folks all received your tax bills recently, and the increase was what? Just a little bit? No, just like that? Or was it a little bigger?
Bigger.
Yeah, it was a little bigger this time out, wasn't it? Well, that's going to keep happening unless we get some new economic development in town to help offset the rise in municipal expenditures. Sending your kids to school is not going to get any cheaper going into the future. So let's, let's talk about cost of community service studies. When I talk about community services, what am I talking about? I'm talking about fire, police, your Department of Public Works taking care of the roads and the water lines. We're talking your library. We're talking all the folks at Town Hall. We're talking your senior center. And we're talking the schools. That's what your local tax dollars pay for. Now, There's such a thing out there called a cost of community service study. And what it does is it attempts to determine how much in tax revenue certain types of land development generate versus how much it costs the town to service. So who prepares these studies? Institutions of higher learning, civic advocacy organizations, and municipal research bureaus. So we're lucky enough to have a Sterling-specific cost of community service study. It was done by the American Farmland Trust back in 2009. There's a handout from those folks up at front. Now, they've done cost of community service studies for about 50 to 60 New England towns, and they all show the same thing, that economic development provides more in tax revenue than it costs the town to service them. If we were to repeat the study today for Sterling, the difference would be minimal. It'd be a few cents here, it'd be a few cents there. So the Sterling study, for every tax dollar generated by residential development, it costs the town $1.09 to service. So for every tax dollar from residential development, town's actually losing out by 9 cents. There's really only one type of housing that pays more in taxes than it costs to service. Anyone want to make a guess?
Condos.
Condos?
No, not condos.
40B?
No.
Waterfront?
Senior housing.
Senior. We don't have much.
Well, we're working on that too. Senior housing, the obvious reason is they're not putting kids into your school system. So that's really the only type of residential development where it pays more in taxes than it costs in services. Commercial and industrial development. For every tax dollar they generate, it only costs the town 26 cents to service. So that's a net winner in taxes for the town, big time. And the same for farming and open space. For every dollar they generate in taxes, it only costs the town 34 cents to service. So let's take a look at some tax statistics here from around the region. I tried to use towns in our region that I thought were somewhat comparable to Sterling in terms of population size, tax-based composition. So the top of this table here, you've got the town name. I used all Worcester County towns except for the town of Stowe, which is in the next county. I thought it was close enough to Sterling, and it's the comparable community, so I added them to it. Second column is the average single family tax bill for those communities for 2023. The third column is how much that tax bill has risen since 2015, and the last column, that is commercial, C, and I, industry, as a percentage of the town's overall tax base. So if we look at the top of this table, the five communities in the top, we see that three of them have average single family home tax bills that are $11,000 or more every year. And we see the increase, 3,000 here, 3,000 there, pretty hefty increase. And then we see as a percentage of their tax base, commercial and industrial is well under 10%. So now let's take a look at some communities where the commercial and industrial tax base is over 10%. That's the bottom of the table here. Athol, Clinton, Charlton, Oxford, West Boylston, Westminster, and Sterling. We see that none of those communities have average single-family home tax bills any higher than $6,800. The increase from year to year, only one of them had, well, since 2015, only one of them topped 2,000, and that was West Boylston. And then you see the percentage of commercial and industrial as a percentage of their tax base. Everyone's over 10%, including Sterling, 11.73% of your tax base is made up of commercial and industrial development. So the trends that we see here. On average, towns with significant commercial and industrial development as a percentage of their tax base, or they have lower single-family tax bills, and the rise in those tax bills from year to year is smaller than those communities that don't have a lot of commercial and industrial development. Bedroom communities, those are towns that make up less than 10% of their tax base with commercial and industrial development. They typically have higher single-family home tax bills, and the year-to-year rise in those tax bills is higher than those communities that do have significant commercial and industrial development. Now that holds true for our region. It holds true for the western part of the state. Not so much the closer you get to Boston. Closer you get to Boston, the higher the land values, and you see towns all around Boston that have high tax bills and their municipal expenditures are very high. It all has to do with the value of the land. Location, location, location. Okay, so economic development. What do we mean by economic development? It means what we want it to mean. We largely control our fate. We articulate what we want to see for economic development through our zoning bylaw. It doesn't have to mean a McDonald's. It doesn't have to mean a Home Depot. It doesn't have to be a CVS or a mobile station with 20 gas pumps. We set our own fate, and we do it through our zoning. So for industrial development, let's talk about what they look for. They look for good highway access, a mile away from, at least a mile or less from a major state highway. We have that. Municipal water and sewer. Well, we're one for two on that. We have municipal water. We don't have municipal sewer anywhere in town. And they look for parcels of land 20 acres or more. We don't have a lot of those. We've only got five of them, and three of them are landlocked. So let me give you a few land use statistics for Sterling. Total size, about 20,000 acres. 38% of the land is permanently protected and will never be developed. That's a sizable amount of protected land for a rural community like Sterling. Approximately 13% of the land has limited protection. The state has what's known as the Chapter 61 Reduced Taxation Program. And that's where if you use your land for forestry, agriculture, or recreation, you get a reduced tax rate for as long as you continue using it for that purpose. The minute you want to pull it out of the program and sell it, you pay a hefty tax penalty, and the town gets the right of first refusal to buy that land. That doesn't happen very often, but it is possible that if a piece of property comes on the market that the town really wants to buy, it can. I don't know many towns that have a lot of money left over for land purchase. So for something like that, you probably need to work it out with one of the region's land trusts. Okay, 93% of the land is owned for residential development. The remaining 7% for commercial and industrial development. You've only got 161 acres left for commercial and industrial development. 19 acres in your commercial districts and 142 in your industrial. Sterling zoning bylaw allows for residential development in the commercial district. And we might want to change that at some point. Of all of your parcels in the commercial district, 43% of them are used for residential purposes. So what that means is you're slowly eating away all of your commercially zoned land with residential development. Of commercial, Main Street, this is the Village Center District. Mm-hmm. You've got
condominiums next to the police station.
Condos next to the police station, that's all commercially zoned land. Yeah, well, I don't have a zoning map handy, but I could show you on a map where residential development is taking place within your commercial districts. So we'll have to move on that one. I don't have that handy. So now we're going to talk about the performance zone. Can you go one slide ahead?
Back or ahead?
Ahead. Okay, so this is your zoning map right here. The performance zone is this red area right here. It's down in the south of town along Route 140, frontage on Lake Hill Road and Dana Hill Road, very close to the I-190 interchange in West Boylston. So let's go back now. Yeah, that's a very good question. It's set forth in your zoning bylaw, 10 whole pages of bylaw on that. Yes, ma'am. And it's also governed by 15 pages of regulations. They read like a Kafka novel. If you can find someone in town who can make heads and tails out of what's allowed in the performance district and what's not, please send it my way. I've lost my wired up for television, so I'm gonna make sure people hear me. We good to go? Okay. The language in the bylaw and the regulations is very confusing and it's contradictory. And the consequence is not very many people have made use of the performance zone to put anything new in town. Whatever we want to do with the performance zone, we need to simplify that bylaw and make it easier to read and understand.
I have to say that I asked my brother-in-law, who's involved in construction in Worcester, where performance zone was. He had no idea. I asked a cousin who was involved in government in Waltham, where performance zone was. He had no idea what he was talking about. I mean, these are two people that we know, and you know.
It is a Sterling-specific creation. How's that for diplomacy? Yeah, put in about 30, 40 years ago by now, And people haven't made much use of it because it's so confusing. So we want to fix that.
How about we just change the name to something else?
That's a good idea too. We could call this the Gateway Commercial District, or the Enterprise Zone or something. We'll come up with a catchy name. But let's move on here. Your performance zone, it has 22 acres of land, frontage on Route 140, Leg Road and Dana Hill Road, municipal water, but no sewer. 83 acres in size, and you've still got 25 acres available for new development. Now, in terms of sizable economic development, you've really only got two areas in town where that's possible. And the performance zone represents your most immediate opportunity because there's 25 acres of vacant developable land there that we could build on now. Your other opportunity is the land across from Demola's, Miola's Ice Cream Parlor. The gravel pits owned by Onyx and Amarillo. A while back in 2006, you changed the zoning of that area to industrial development. Once Onyx and Amarillo finish pulling all the gravel out of that area, you're going to have a flat piece of land that's pad ready for industrial development. But that's 15 to 20 years down the road. It's going to take them that long to clear that area out of its gravel and leave you with a flat piece of land for industrial development. So if you want economic development in the near future, it's a performance zone. The largest parcel in the performance zone is 23 acres, and it's the nursing home. Now remember a few slides back when I talked about what new industries look for industrial development. They're looking for parcels 20 acres in size. You really don't have that in the performance zone. You have smaller parcels. So the performance zone, it's never going to be an Amazon warehouse or a large Home Depot. You just don't have the parcel size for that. If there's industrial development that goes in there, it's going to be small scale. Next slide. So this is a map of the performance zone. I'm going to come up here and point to a few things. Okay, you've got some vacant developable land in back of the greenhouse. You've got some on the other side of Dana Hill Road across from the cemetery, and then up back along Route 140. Next slide, please. So let's take a little driving tour along the performance zone, shall we? I'll go back one. So there's your intersection, 140 Dana Hill Road, Leg Road.
Next one?
Yeah. There's the cemetery. The cemetery is permanently protected land. I know there's been some current concerns about including it in the performance zone. To satisfy those concerns, we can pull the cemetery right out of the performance zone. Doesn't have to be in there, not a problem. Okay, the Apple Healthcare building. Now we're looking at the greenery. Musby Falls, we see all the pumpkins. Next slide. Now we're looking back in the back of the greenery over an embankment, and that's Leg Road in the background. This is actually two parcels, and it is available for economic development. The catch here is that these two properties are under the review jurisdiction of the Massachusetts Division water supply protection. Meaning that if economic development were to go there, they would need to be part of the review process.
Question? The parcels, are you talking about the wooded area beyond Lake Road?
No, we're talking this land in specific, behind the greenhouse.
Isn't this owned by the greenhouse?
Yes, it is.
So as long as they own it, it's really not available for new development?
Well, they could sell it or develop it themselves.
Okay.
Next slide, please. Now we're looking in back of the greenhouse. Next slide. This is me. I've just turned around like this, and I'm looking at the residential building on the greenhouse property. This could be an artisanal pizza shop. It could be an ice cream parlor. Could be a farm-to-table operation at some point. Any number of commercial uses could go in there. Next slide. Now we're on the other side of the street on Dana Hill Road. We've got the industrial building, self-storage in back. Now we're a little further down Dana Hill Road. This is a sign into the elderly housing complex.
It's a nursing home.
Nursing home. This is their building right there. Next slide. Now we're walking north along Route 140, looking east. Single family home, an old barn that's ripe for tear down and development. Next slide. And a big piece of vacant developable land. Next slide. Okay, so that's the area that we're talking about. So now let's talk about what Sterling allows for commercial development. We're going to talk about what Sterling allows for commercial development by right versus special permit. Here's how approving land use projects works in Massachusetts. For uses that a town allows by right, it means that the planning board, through the site plan approval process, can work with the developer and the abutters to help shape how the project fits into the neighborhood, the landscaping, the screening, the lighting, the what have you. But eventually, they have to approve it. It's by right. You're going to get to yes eventually. So here's what Sterling allows for commercial uses by right. Everyone see the list there? I won't bother reading that in detail. Let's go to the next slide. Now this is what Sterling allows by special permit. Special permit is different in that if they get to the end of the permitting process and the permitting board does not believe that the use is appropriate for the neighborhood, they can say no at the end of the permitting process. In Sterling, the vast majority of special permits is issued by the zoning board. So if they review a project through the special permit process and at the end they haven't been able to shape it to fit into the neighborhood, they can ultimately say no. I will tell you this, for businesses and industries that are looking for new towns to move into, when they look at the town zoning bylaw and they see that their business is only allowed by special permit, they're going to go to the next town that allows them by right. So we've got a lot of uses that are allowed by special permit. Some of them might be more appropriate to make by right, and certainly some of the new uses that we're going to come up with today will probably make them by right. Okay, so here's what other communities allow for commercial development. And I looked at comparable communities, Acton, Holden, West Boylston, and Westminster. Now, a little story about the first item, retail stores limited to 25,000. That's from Westminster. About 20 years ago, they were approached by Home Depot to build like a 60,000 square foot megastore right off of Route 2. And the town did not want that. So once Home Depot was chased out of town, the town said, well, what can we do in our zoning to fix that? Well, what's the largest commercial building in Westminster? It's Vincent's Country Store. Everyone know Vincent's? Vincent's is about 25,000 square feet, so they made that their cap for the amount of floor space that any retail store could have. If you're concerned about mega stores coming into town, we could put in something like that as well. And the other uses you see here, everybody get a look at that? Okay, let's move on to the next slide. Audience participation time, are you ready? So we've talked about the performance zone. What I want to hear from you is what you would like to see in the performance zone for commercial and industrial uses.
Nothing.
That's going to be an option too. Let me talk about that right now.
You know, one of the problems is there, you got a bad intersection with a bad light and you got no room to put a left turn coming out of Dana Hill Road. Right? So you got a traffic jam and an accident waiting to happen every day there. Okay, I got the light halfway fixed because there was a dead battery in the light box thing over there. All right, so now in the morning, you know, the people coming from Lake Road have the right of way first, and the people coming out of Dana Hill Road have a delayed green, okay? But the people on Lake Road don't know that the people have a delayed green, all right? So they're still trying to come across. You still have to be careful. But the Massachusetts people that do the traffic stuff there, whatever their name is, okay, they told me that they would never put a dedicated green light there for a left turn because they have no room for two lanes. They need two lanes, okay? So you got a big, that Christoph man, the crane across the street, it's like you're going down an embankment there, okay? So all of that would have to like be filled in, and the blue house on the corner would have to be demolished so that they could make lanes, okay? So you got problems in that performance zone there for traffic. So that's why you don't need anything there.
Well, you talk to an engineer, where there's a will, there's a way. So let's focus on what we'd like to see there, and then we'll find a way to get there. So let me say this about your point. If at the end of this presentation you say to me, Steve, you made a decent case for economic development, but we'd still like to see that area as rural farmland, single family houses. That's your choice. And if the majority of folks tell us that's what they want, then that's what we'll do. Yes?
So, one of the things I would like to see considered, I'm Paul Austin, one that would be potentially independent living, assisted living type community with access to 19, so they would have access to the mass memorial system, their access to COA, I think contribute from a tax base. So I think it would be a good opportunity to consider that.
Okay, now I'm going to write down your idea. No development, rural farmland. Other ideas in the back there.
Yes, Mr. Wallace, John Kilcoyne. I was just wondering, what a driving range and golf facility, not necessarily a Topgolf, but a driving range and golf facility, what kind of zoning would allow that? Would there be special permits required? And that's the question.
We had one in Sterling before.
Right.
And then it went away.
Well, we're going to be resetting the rules for the performance zone. So if that's something folks want, we can make it by right. Let me put down driving range. Roseanne.
Multi-use property. Doors on the bottom, housing on the top.
John, you could just go up on a cow pasture.
Charles, you got one?
I do. I didn't make it over Roseanne, so that's nice.
Give him to the punch. Yes?
Well, I agree with what Roseanne said. Let's keep the stores kind of the rural vibe, you know, farm stands and that. You know, we can keep the vibe of the community without, well, increasing the tax revenue.
One of the ideas that we got from Wednesday night's meeting was a farmer's co-op.
Love that.
Is that anything you'd be interested in?
Yeah.
Other ideas? Yes, sir.
On the driving range, is that a recreational facility and is that allowed by right?
Right now?
I don't remember. Hard to read from back here, and it was quickly shown, but golf, I think a golf driving range is considered recreational, is it not?
It would be.
And I didn't see anywhere on that list educational use. Was that not allowed by anything in town?
Education? Educational uses are subject to a zoning exception. There's a half a dozen things that the state allows zoning exemptions for: educational uses, religious uses, help me out here, farming, solar.
So the dance academy is an educational use and it's?
No, that's for profit.
So you can't have for-profit education?
I don't know what the distinction is for profit and non-profit education. We can put down educational uses. Are you thinking maybe like a satellite campus or a college or just a regular?
When I served on zoning, we approved a cheer academy on Dana Hill Road in a commercial building, and it was brought to us as educational use, and then I don't see it on the list anywhere today. I was thinking the Sterling Inn may be a good use for a co-op program for Monty Tech.
Yeah, that'd be great. Yeah.
Yes, sir. So you consider a medical campus when you think about those colleges and the universities, an extension of UMass or all the other even VA, consider a medical campus.
Okay, I'm glad no one said biotech so far. When I was doing the master plan for Westminster, one of our economic development people said, oh, we ought to bring in biotech. And that's when our DPW director said to us, do you have any idea how much water biotech requires and how much wastewater they generate? Westminster gets their water and sewer from Pittsburgh, and they're only allotted a certain amount. And one biotech use would eat up all of Westminster's water and sewer. So that's not going to be a use that we'll see here. Other ideas? Yes, sir.
I just think more shops and restaurants. I think you said it before, the farm table option. Keep it quaint, but have more variety. Not another pizza shop, we don't need that. I mean, and it's saturated with pizza. But something to give a little more flavor of a rural environment where you're not having to go elsewhere all the time for a decent restaurant.
Okay. All right. Unless anybody else has any other ideas, we're going to move on to our next exercise. That pile, that pile. So here's what we're going to do now. Everybody's going to get a strip of four green dots. What I want you to do is go up to these charts here and place a green dot on what you would like to see in the performance zone. Place it right on top of the use, not next to it, not underneath it or above it. Place a green dot on what you want to see. Let's take 5 minutes to do that, and then we'll reconvene.
I can use tool tags.
Well,
all right. are you?
Good, how are you?
Good, thank you.
You want me to be open-minded about it? You know what, I've been here for 35 years, okay?
I got a 17%.
Well, I hate to know where you live.
Sandy Ridge.
Sorry.
There lies the problem.
There lies the problem. You chose that.
What do they got to eat over here?
I need to add one more. dog park. I own dogs, and I think we'll like to have a park and have them run around.
I'll see if you can write it in.
Yeah.
That's what the other, that's where all the DCR were, so for a while.
Yeah, exactly. To be determined. To be determined.
So that's an example, right? Like, we will talk about making it more, we can have a public council, how we balance it, what we hope will impact the community.
I like dogs, but I don't want a dog.
While respecting the facilities, we only had made decisions that we should have a perspective by Terry they have a policy department. So that's like a huge thing. And I work on that. There's been cuts in services in play, and so my point is more that we're fighting as a future. I don't think that this has much to do with services being moved to Worcester or other places, or Leicester especially. So it is happening, and one possible they're also competing with, you know, getting higher numbers
All right, are we just about done with our red dots?
You know, it's a very complicated issue. There's so many other factors, but it's an ongoing.
I think it's only.
So maybe that's one thing I like.
If you're done with the red dots, let's come on back. Okay, so we're going to wrap things up here. Here's our next steps. The planning board and I will take your feedback that you've given us today, and we are going to spend the spring and the summer translating your preferences into changes to the zoning bylaw. We will, of course, review those changes with town council, and then we will present our changes to Sterling's various boards, commissions, and committees to explain what we want to do and why we want to do it. We'll get their feedback. Then we'll hold another public forum or two, just like this, where we come back to you and say, all right, we heard what you wanted for the performance zone. Here's what we came up with. What do you think? What we want to do is involve you at every step of the process so that by the time this gets to town meeting in 2025, you know what you're proposing, you know what we're proposing, you were involved in the bylaws creation, and you're comfortable with it and hopefully willing to support it. The last thing we want to do, which has been Sterling's history, is you show up at town meeting, see a big zoning change on the warrant, and you go, what the hell is this? What are they doing? So this is a bottoms-up planning approach where we involve you every step of the way so that there are no surprises at town meeting, and hopefully you can get behind this. The planning board is beginning a three-year odyssey to rewrite your vintage 1970 zoning bylaw, update it, modernize it, make it easier to read and easier to use.
Could you get rid of performance zone?
We'll come up with a better name than that. So this year we're working on the commercial and industrial aspects of zoning. Next year we're going to work on the residential aspects, and then the year after that we'll work on whatever left over, your parking bylaw, your sign bylaw, and in the end you're going to have a modern, up-to-date zoning bylaw. So that's it. Thank you everyone for coming out and participating, sir.
I have two questions. Going back to where you said that the ratio between $1 of taxes and so many dollars or cents for services, in the commercial, the services were very low. Is that just because they don't have school kids?
That's a big, big part of it, yes.
Is it that big a jump?
Yeah.
Okay.
You will see from the Farmland Trust handout that that's pretty much across the board for all communities.
And another thing, I see we have a couple of like nursing home kinds of things here. When we got our nursing home up on Dana Hill, the ambulance calls increased considerably. So that's part of our ratio.
Yeah, you're right.
That has increased a lot. Probably yeah. Kept them in business.
Yeah, you're right. Sir.
So this is a dramatic, we want to move the needle that has a major impact on our town, especially with the escalating costs that are going on, which are far outpacing inflation right now.
So the town's total operating budget for the next fiscal year is around $29 million. If we were to develop all of the vacant developable land in the performance zone, we could generate as much as $400,000 in new tax revenue. Now that will help keep the year-to-year rise in your single-family tax bill smaller than what it would be if that land were developed. So keep that in mind as well. All right. That's all I've got. Yes.
On the taxing, I was on the MRPC when I was on the planning board in Sterling, and I think we went through all the taxing and stuff like that. I believe the Sterling amount that went to schools was almost 75% of the tax bill.
No, it's 50. It's more like 50% now. All right, folks. Yes. Yes,
ma'am. How many families pay property tax in town?
How many families? Everybody that owns a single family.
Well, I'm just thinking. You said 400,000, and if you had a number to divide into, you could think of like how much that would affect.
Oh gosh, what do you got? About 2,800 housing units in town.
Oh, all some are rental. Some people rent.
Right. So 2,800 housing units, whether rental or single family or duplexes. These are your total number of housing units, approximately 2,800.
Okay. Thank you.
That's all I got for you. Thanks very much for coming out on a Saturday morning and helping us through this. Please stay tuned. If you've got any questions along the way, planning and zoning-wise, just give me a call, send me an email, stop by my office. My door is always open. Thanks, everyone.